It's been a couple of weeks since my last review, but this should make up for it because this is going to be a bit of an epic. Instead of looking at just an unusual game today, I'm going to look at an unusual bit of hardware with 15 games installed on it. It's a TV game called The Rumble Station. And this is quite unusual in that it's not just a normal Famiclone that's got like things like Gradius and Contra and stuff like that on it. It's actually got built into it 15 games which were unlicensed NES games released by a company called Color Dreams. If you want to know more about them, probably easy just to look them up on Wikipedia or whatever. But basically they got around the NES lockout chip with their special cartridges and published a lot of generally terrible games on the NES. This is pretty much the only way to get those games in the UK on this Rumble Station. Not sure who manufactured this. I don't have a fact file about it as such, because I'm not sure who manufactured it. I don't even remember how much I paid for it. I bought it on a car boot sale for probably no more than £2 or £3. You can pick them up on eBay for between 10 and 15 quid. So let's waste no further time. Let's have a look at the packaging and the Rumble Station console and then take a look at those 15 games and see whether any of them are actually worth playing. First up then, let's take a look at the packaging that the device comes in. So as you can see, it says Video Rumble Station All-in-One Game Machine. It's got a picture of the device there and a picture of the screen with the 15 games on. At the bottom there, it confirms 15 pre-programmed games included. So moving on to the back, we've got a little bit more information. Press start, unsurprisingly. RF and AV cables supplied for connection to any UK television, 15 pre-programmed games, plug and play on your TV, adventure, classic, shooting, role play and action games. And it's got some pictures of some of the games there: Challenge of the Dragon, Master Chew, Pradicus Conflict, Operation Secret Storm, Menace Beach, Pest Terminator, Raid 2020, Baby Boomer, Robo Demons. And a bit of other information there. Oh, there's some more games there. I missed those. Basically all the 15 games, it looks like, are listed on the back there. Another picture of the device itself as well. So let's get the box open now and have a look inside. Quite difficult to do this one-handed. There's the instruction manual, which we'll take a look at in a minute. But there's one thing you can't fault them for. It's the number of AV connectors they provide with this thing. So we've got typical AV connection. We've got, in case you want to plug it into a SCART socket, we've got a SCART adapter. And if that wasn't enough, it's also got an RF cable and a power supply. This thing doesn't run off batteries, it only runs off a power supply. Just quickly show the connectors there on the front of it. So you've got RF connector, the two AV connectors, power switch, and the DC 9 volts in. All of which is upside down because I've turned it the wrong way around, but there you go. And so we'll take a look at the controller in a little bit more detail in a minute. Let's have a look at the manual. So there's a Rumble Station on the front. Warnings and precautions. We don't follow the warnings and precautions. Let's move on. Bit more about hardware precautions and maintenance. And so let's move on. We've got the components, which tells you the what all the buttons do on the controller itself. AC adapter, various connectors as I've just been showing. Tells you how to connect it up. Pretty comprehensive stuff there. How to operate it, turn the television on, plug it in, turn it on. Pretty simple stuff. How to turn off the Rumble Station. I wonder, could it be to switch the power switch off? And on the back page, there's even a troubleshooting guide. That's not the back page, actually. There's another page here. There's a helpline, amazingly. So you can see there, this was distributed in the UK, at least by Systema, who also did some things like the TV Boy, which had 120 odd Atari games built into it. It's a similar sort of idea to that. Incredibly dodgy stuff, but they seem to get away with it. So here's a quick list of the 15 games, and this is where the fact that it was probably originated in China comes to the fore. So we've got Baby Boomer, Help the Kid to Eliminate the Obstacle. Captain Comic, Jump the Obstacle. Very detailed instructions there. Challenge of the Dragon, Kill the Enemies in the Midnight.
Crystal mines. A tank not only can push the mines but also kill the enemies. Okay. Galactic Crusader. Fighter plane in the universe. King Neptune's treasure. Adventure looking for the lost treasure. Let's just go to some highlights here because I'm getting bored of reading these. Many speeches. Slide the skid. Operation Secret Storm is Iraq versus Kuwait. Raid 2020, rid the drug dealer, or Durler as it says there, and get to the ship to escape. Robodemons defeat death to enter Hades. And let's just go to the last one there. The Predacus conflict, nicely described as war in the space. Let's just take a closer look at the controller itself then. So we've got the rumble pack in the middle there. We've got an analog stick and also a D-pad and four buttons and select and start in the middle, and also this switch, which is one player or two player. I'm not really sure what that's used for. All my games are going to be one player anyway. I can only assume there's a possibility that some of the games are designed to use the second player in a different port, and that switches between the ports internally in the software. One thing I wanted to mention is, in case you haven't worked out what this might be modelled on, this controller, here's a Dreamcast controller next to it. I think there's not much doubt there that that's where it got its inspiration from. And the analog stick, by the way, does absolutely nothing different to the D-pad. It's effectively just a D-pad. And the two buttons there with the arrows on are effectively auto-fire buttons for the A and B buttons. So effectively, just like a normal NES pad, it's left, right, up, down, A, B, select and start. So I've got the Rumble Station plugged in now, and we'll look at the games in a moment. But first, I just wanted to show the Rumble action on this device. There's nothing clever about it whatsoever. You might have thought they've somehow reprogrammed the games to allow Rumble action to occur at certain points in the game. Nothing like that. Basically, the way it works is that when you press any of the buttons, the Rumble pack activates. For some reason, it activates less when it's on auto fire than it does with these buttons. But that's it. There's no rumbling for any of the controls on the sort of D-pad or the analog stick, which basically are both D-pads as well. So yeah, basically the rumbling is limited entirely to when you press the action buttons. And to be perfectly honest, it's incredibly annoying. So here we have the title screen, the menu screen for the 15 games. Quite colourful stars floating around in the background, otherwise it's pretty basic stuff, just white text for the game names. And you select the games by moving up and down the list with the up and down on the D-pad. And press start to start a game. What I'm going to do, I can't review all 15 of these games in detail, so I'm going to go through the not so good, or even worse, there's probably a better way to describe it, games first, quickly, and just show a couple of minutes from each of those, and then I'm going to focus on a few games that are perhaps a little bit more worthy of attention. So first up we have Captain Comic, which is actually a port of a PC shareware game released very early in the days of PC gaming, in the early 90s. This version's definitely got better graphics than that version, which had horrible EGA graphics, also better sound. The graphics on this are actually quite nice, but unfortunately it's a bit of a boring scrolling platformer. Not a great deal happens. I don't recall the PC version very well, but I'm pretty sure that was kind of boring as well. So not a great game, although it does look and sound reasonably nice. Nothing really spectacular going on within the game. It's just a case of walk along, shoot some stuff, pick things up and so on. Next up we have Challenge of the Dragon, which is one of numerous scrolling beat-em-up type games on this little device, all of which are very similar. You scroll along, walk along left to right for a small amount of time, and then you happen across an enemy or two which you fight.
And then once you get past them, you move on a little bit further. Lots of very repetitive enemies, very repetitive backgrounds, nothing very great to talk about. The end of each level you'll face some kind of enemy, usually something that flies around. This one's obviously set in sort of, I don't know, Japanese feudal times or something like that. You've got a sword, but strangely some of the people you fight seem to be almost look like gangsters, so it's a bit peculiar. So all in all, although the graphics background wise aren't too bad, quite nicely drawn, it's not really a great game and easily forgettable within 30 seconds of playing it really. King Neptune's Adventure is definitely one of the worst games on this device, and they're pretty bad games generally anyway, so that says something about this game. You play King Neptune, you've got to move around an underwater sort of landscape, picking things up and shooting various creatures and so forth. The big problem with this, at certain points the graphics get very seriously corrupted, and basically it's just really boring and also quite difficult. Not much fun at all, and not really worth saying anything else about it really. The next game is Master Chu and the Drunkard Hu, to give it its full title. Another game set in sort of ancient China, I think this one. The idea on each level is to collect a certain number of the yin yang symbols, some of which are easy to see, some of which are hidden, and you have to kick or navigate around various objects to collect them. There's lots of little enemies like spiders and worms and things trying to attack you and drain your health. After you've collected 8 of the symbols on each level, the level completes and you move to some kind of end of level boss and then on to another level. Again, the graphics not spectacular on this, very similar backgrounds to Challenge of the Dragon in fact, and the main character's kind of a lot of white and a little bit of yellow and not much else. The enemies are very unvaried as well, and overall it's just a fairly boring game, scrolling platformer, but nothing very notable to say about it. Next up we have Moonranger, which is quite an interesting premise but not very well carried out. The first part of the game is a scrolling shoot 'em up. You pilot a quite nicely designed ship that can move, or shoot I should say, backwards and forwards, eliminating asteroids and little spacemen, and finally an end of level sort of baddie, and then you progress to a platforming stage, which again throws a lot of enemies at you and there's various things to pick up and use. But the big problem with both parts is that even though the graphics are quite nice, it's really really slow and progression through it is very slow, and really not worth the effort in all honesty. Thank you. Next up we have Operation Secret Storm, which was inspired by a certain war in the Gulf in the early 90s. And the aim of the game is to make your way across Iraq and shoot or punch various enemies. The weirdest thing about this game is the end of the first stage, the end of level boss is a giant eagle, which seems a bit of a peculiar thing. Looks wise, it's kind of dull looking, not very great graphics. It kind of has a little bit of a look like Metal Slug, although Metal Slug came after this, but it's nothing like that game in all honesty. Lots of white, as you can see, lots of enemies that are all white, and the main character's all white as well. Mixture of beat 'em up and shoot 'em up action, but either way, it's very boring. Scroll from left to right, beat a few things up, kill a few giant eagles, and then move on to the next stage. The next game is Pest Terminator, which is effectively a simulation of exterminating various beasties from a house. You run around the house, upstairs and downstairs through various doors, hitting things with a hammer, and I guess the idea is to clear all the enemies from a particular house, but I got bored of the game before I even finished the first stage. It does seem to have been produced in association with a company called Western Exterminator Company. I'm not quite sure why they thought they'd want to lend themselves to a video game, but the character that's in the game is called Colonel Cleanup, and he's a registered trademark of that company. Graphics wise, it's not too bad. Quite a bit of variety from room to room within the game, and a lot of different enemies, but the aim of the game is all the same, just basically hit them all with a hammer, so it's pretty boring stuff to be honest. The next game is Raid 2020, which suggests it be set in the future, and yet when you look at the game it looks like it's more likely set in sort of 1950s gangster territory. So the idea of the game is basically to eliminate a lot of drug dealers. It's really crap game, run and gun style gameplay and a bit of picking up items and stuff like that, but the graphics are pretty terrible on it. It's got a really strange perspective when you're moving up and down each level. You kind of move at a slight sort of isometric perspective, which just makes it more difficult to navigate things like landmines, of which there are a lot on the levels. There also seems to be some items that you can't pick up because they're out of reach, and there's a lot of flicker on this game as well. The graphics are not very nice, and overall it's a pretty terrible game. This is Robo Demons, which is a rarity for a NES game as far as I'm aware, in that it's got some speech in it. Not that it's particularly good speech. The idea of the game seems to be to take on the various denizens of hell, death and Satan and so on. There's lots of skeletons and winged flying demons and such like. To start off with, it's a scrolling shoot 'em up, which soon turns into a platform game, neither of which are particularly good, and there's an inordinate amount of grey and red colour used on the graphics, and not to mention a lot of white, which as I've already said is prevalent across a number of these Colour Dreams games. Next up we have Secret Scout in the Temple of Demise, to give it its full title. And you seem to be in this one playing a Boy Scout. It's another one of these scrolling beat-em-up type games. You move from left to right across a few screens. The screens then stop. You fight a few enemies. You move on a little bit more when you've beaten them, and so on and so forth. At the end of the level, you move into a temple which you have to navigate, which is lots of really boring platforms and ladders, all of which look the same. And basically, after a few screens of that, you come across three enemies, all of which are armed with machine guns that quickly wipe out all your lives. And that was basically it. After that, I couldn't be bothered to play any more of it. And finally, for these quick overviews, we have the Predacus Conflict, which is probably the best of the games that I'm not focusing it on in any detail. It's kind of like a 2D version of Elite, I suppose. You pilot a ship, you can buy various items, shields, weapons and so forth. You collect currency by shooting enemies, and eventually I think the aim is to navigate certain planets and eliminate all the enemies on them. Unfortunately, when you do that, what seems to happen is the first planet you land on, you get annihilated straight away and it's game over. So while it's got some interesting ideas around it, it's very hard to actually play and not very interesting. The control of the ship is kind of like a sort of cross between Asteroids and Bosconian, really difficult to control, and that just makes it frustrating as well. Not much variety in the enemies either from what I've seen, although there is a bit of variety in the backgrounds. When you land on a planet, it has got some sort of green and blue as befits a planet's surface, as opposed to the space scenes which you play through at the start of the game. So all in all, it's not too bad, but not really worthy of any more attention. So let's now take a look in a little bit more detail at the last four games on the Rumble Station. And the first of those four that I'm going to look at is Menace Beach, which is probably the most infamous of the Color Dreams games because it's got some partial nudity in it, which obviously Nintendo wouldn't have been very happy about. So let's load that up. And the title screen's fairly basic, but it's got a nice graphic of the main character there on his skateboard. So let's get the game started. Straight away you see that the main character's girlfriend's been captured by somebody and is not very happy about it. She's frowning and she's tied up and wants you to go and rescue her. So the game is effectively a scrolling platformer set in along streets, and you ride a skateboard, which makes your character rather difficult to control. People throw things out the window at you, which obviously do damage to you. You can jump on these things, I think, somehow. No, maybe not. You can pick these bottles up somehow as well, which I can't do. Give it another try. There you go, so you can pick the bottles up and throw them at people. So obviously in this modern urban setting, you've obviously got ninjas coming after you, so you can throw the bottles at the ninjas to kill them. You can also fight them. You've got two buttons basically, obviously, for jumping and also fighting in some way, which is either throwing the bottles or you can punch and kick, or punch mainly. So you can also do like a flying spin attack, which does a lot more damage if you can make it connect, but it's quite difficult to make it connect. So again, just gonna try and fight this ninja. There you go, that's what I was talking about when the jets spray you up into the air. And then from there you should be able to jump to get that heart, I think, but you can't because you can't jump high enough. So I'm not quite sure what went wrong there. Well, bad programming, I imagine, like most of these games. There you go, that was a spin attack. There's a clown there, which throws stuff at you. Just ignore him. Another ninja. Got rid of him, and I think that's the end of the level. Possibly not, there might be another ninja to get rid of. No, there we go, that's the end of the first world. That was the first world. Not very complex. So as you can see, it reveals that she's been captured by Demon Dan, and some of her clothes have started to already disappear, if you can spot that there, and every time it cuts back to it, she's got less and less clothes on. Obviously that's what Nintendo wouldn't have been too pleased about. The second level looks like it's a slight rip-off of Mario Brothers' second level, Super Mario, I should say. So you're in a kind of a sewer, there's various things bouncing around, these things throw you off course, there's light switches as well, there's springs in the floor. There you go, there's a light switch which has been unhappily switched off by that frog thing that's bouncing around. So yeah, basically lots of things that can make you cause you some kind of discomfort or whatever. There's a heart that can be picked up there just to improve your health a bit. And on this level, the enemies aren't ninjas, they are Elvis impersonators. Again, not quite sure why there's a load of Elvis impersonators in a sewer, but there are. So let's try and get rid of Elvis here. Oh yeah, there's also bombs that go off on the floor. So there are some sort of more challenging, puzzling aspects to this stage. And a lot of bouncing around. It's not the worst game on the pack by any means. There's an extra life up there. I'm not sure if I'll be able to get to that. No, I'm not sure how I would, so I'll just skip over it. I'm not bothered about playing it that much anyway. So yeah, the graphics are pretty nice on it actually. A bit more colour than some of the other games, a bit more definition as well. Control is not too bad, it's a bit flaky. It's not the most interesting of games, it's a bit on the boring side. This second level obviously is a bit more encouraging than the first one. Sounds fairly non-existent, there's some, you know, usual sort of fighting, jumping, blipping noises, and the kind of little tune going in the background. I've blown myself up there and also switched the lights off. So I'll just get to the end of this second level and show the third level, and then I think we'll call it a day with this. Not much more to say about it anyway. Oh, done the same thing again there now. We really need to avoid those bombs, which are really difficult to see when the light's off. There we go, light's back on now at least. So I can't get up there, so I've got to somehow get up onto that higher up platform. Oh, yeah, annoying timed jumps that are quite difficult to do. For the bomb to go off again. Oh, come on. Oh, now I've switched the light off again. Yeah, so the control's quite tricky, as you can see. That was close, nearly in the water there. Oh, I just made it. So there's another Elvis at the end of this stage here. Shaking his hips. I just noticed he's just like a shaking hips attack. It's quite funny. And that's the end of level 2 again. Nothing too challenging. Slightly more challenging than the first one. And the lady's clothes have come off a little bit more. And she's saying her clothes are starting to rot, which seems very unlikely unless she's been there for a really, really long time. And so we're back outside now and there's more ninjas. Two ninjas this time to make it a little bit more challenging. So perhaps the only other notable thing about this game is that it was actually re-released later in the life of Colour Dreams when they changed the name to Wisdom Tree and started doing religious-based games. They took all the rotting clothes and stuff out of it. I've never seen that version of it, but apparently it's a lot more, shall we say, religious-friendly. This is getting boring now. I'm just trying to show you some of the other enemies that appear on this screen, on this level, and then we'll sack it off and have a look at the next one. But I'm not looking like I'm not even going to get that far. Oh, there we go, it's not too bad. So again, there's the bomb throwing, whatever it is, in the manhole cover there. There's a big sumo wrestler guy, which if you can get it timed right, you can actually make the bomb explode and kill him. There we go, that should get him actually. Nope. Oh, he's got the way. And on it goes, there's, oh, the sumo wrestler's back again. And I've lost a life, and I'm frankly, I've had enough of that now. So let's move on to the next game. Which is Galactic Crusader. Which looks to have been licensed from another company by Colour Dreams based on this title screen. There you can see it's copyright Sachin Incorporated, which I think might have been a Japanese company, get my words out eventually. So as you can see from the demo, which is quite decent, shows you what you've got to do in the game, it's a upward scrolling shoot 'em up, quite colourful. So let's get on with it. I don't know why there's a witch flying across there, by the way, that seems to be completely irrelevant. So for this one, let's get the auto fire on. And basically you just got to shoot everything that comes on the screen. The drop power-ups, big sort of colourful butterfly kind of main ship, which I imagine is going to cause problems later on being so big. There are lots of different power-ups. That one's quite cool. It's kind of the swirly blue thing. Pretty much everything, every wave of enemies drops a power-up, so there's lots of different ones to choose from. I've been hit there and you can see the size of the ship slightly gone smaller, which I don't necessarily think is a bad thing. The music in the background is quite nice, a bit jolly for a space shoot 'em up, but it's not too bad. The graphics are a bit, shall we say, there's a liberal use of red, white and blue on these graphics, but again, they're not the worst that I've seen on this Rumble station by any means. There's a bit of a strange thing goes on with the background though. You can see some planets sort of appear randomly in the middle of the screen, scrolling down. They don't appear from the top of the screen and scroll down, which is a bit peculiar. It's kind of a bigger enemy swooping around there, which I've got. Oh, and he's exploded. A lot of things explode and then fire bullets out at you, which makes it quite tricky. So it just carries on. There's not a lot to it really, it's just a normal upward scrolling shoot. The upward scrolling is barely worth mentioning. It's basically almost like a Galaga clone, although some of the power-ups are quite good, if I can get one of them in particular. There's a power-up that's a bit like the Force from R-Type. There is an end-of-level boss as well, which I've got to a couple of times, which I've not got past because it's rock hard. Whether I'll get that far, I'm not sure, but I'll carry on playing through until I get a game over, see what happens. It's very repetitive in that there's only certain formations of enemies that come towards you. There's the little sort of flying saucer things. There's these things that kind of swoop backwards and forwards in a Galaga-style formations, maybe. I think it's impossible to get every enemy that comes at you because the screen's so wide. Although I've got them all that time. So that's some kind of invulnerability power-up, I think, because I'm flashing. And I don't know what that is. Let's see if I can dispose of this blue thing this time without getting blown up. There we go. There we go, this is what I was talking about. So here's a kind of force power-up, which you can pull back and bolt on the front of your ship, just like in R-Type. Don't know if it gives you any shields or whatever, but I'll keep hold of it for the time being. Oh no, it's gone now. So I've got, just got hit. So it's not one hit kills. You do get kind of stages of shit, which is like a lot of the shooters done by companies like Compile. It's kind of getting boring already, though. Oh, there goes another life. I think I've got one life left. Way too long between the restart of each level as well, each life, I should say. Oh, get out of the way. Interesting that it doesn't show the score on screen at all during the game. It does show it at the end of the game, which isn't going to be too far off, I believe. I'm hoping I might get to the end of level boss, just so you can see how ingeniously designed it is. Oh, this one looks useful. There's not really any indication when that's coming. The music just plods along, as you've already heard, for the whole of the level, with these strange sort of planets materialising halfway up the screen and then vanishing off. This looks bad. Oh, here we go, here's the end of level boss. So it's just a cube basically, or a square, more accurate, since there's no 3D. So you just unleash on it and hope for the best, but it's quite difficult because it throws a lot of stuff at you. There's a lot of projectiles and also things being spun around the screen. And it keeps vanishing as well, which doesn't really help. Where's it gone? Oh, there it's gone. And that's probably game over now. Oh no, I've got another life. But it sent me back somewhere further back through the level to try and progress through it again. I've got no idea how far. This is going on longer than I thought it would. And it's not that interesting. It's a reasonably well programmed game, but it's just not very good. Almost straight away, and I say I'm dead. I don't know if I'm doing any damage to the thing or not, but that's game over. So just to summarise, at the end of the game it tells you how many of each thing you shot in quite annoying fashion. $28,800, which you only find out at the end of the game. You can continue, but I'm not going to do that because I think you've seen enough. It would be interesting to see what the next level's like, but not that interesting. So next up, we're going to look at Baby Boomer, which is the only game on the device that, as you can see from the title screen, if you can read that, there's some terrible colour clash on the graphics on this. The graphics are pretty awful. It says pull trigger or press start to begin. So this was actually designed to be used with the NES Zapper, which is not included with this pack. So I will be using a crosshairs and a joystick instead. So the best way I can describe how to play it is actually to start playing it. As you can see, it's got a lot of white clashing with pale blue, which makes it quite difficult to see. So let's get on with the game. It says there, help Baby Boomer find his mum, don't shoot the nuggets, 12 adds a baby, and something else that I missed. But basically, you control this crosshairs, and what you've got to do, the baby's walking across the bottom of the screen, and you've got to make sure it doesn't get killed by anything. So you've got to shoot the obstacles. It can pick, these are the nuggets that it was referring to, it can pick those up. So you just got to help the baby traverse the screen without coming to any kind of grief. So you do these things like shooting insects and... What happened? Oh, okay, yeah, I forgot something. Yeah, you've got to keep it stocked up with milk as well. Which was right at the beginning of the level and I forgot. That's milk there. So just get the milk. So yeah, you've got to... prevent the animals, rats, snakes and insects from attacking it. Shoot everything other than the nuggets is pretty much the best way to describe it. Shoot the clouds to generate little bridges for the baby to cross. Keep stocking up on the milk. There's more milk. And you don't want it to run into that big exploding fuel can thing. Here comes a rat, here comes a bouncing thing that I don't know what it is, and a snake. So you basically just got to keep your eyes open for stuff. Oh, I've shot a nugget there, that's bad. Stuff that you want the baby to not get killed by. Oh, like that. Sometimes they come out very close to the baby, other times they're further away. You can also shoot the trees for and birds come out, which I think is just a bonus thing. So I quite like this game. It's quite an interesting concept, not your normal sort of game concept. It's quite hard to do with the crosshairs. It would have been easier with a zapper, I think. As I've mentioned, the graphics are pretty awful, especially the baby, which is a horrible white. You may have noticed there's a lot of white used in these Colour Dreams games for some reason. Ooh, that was close. So I think we're approaching the end of the level. Yeah, it's to the cemetery. Nearly there. Still a couple of baddies to get rid of. We've got 10 nuggets so far, so another 2 will give me an extra baby. So you go, that was the first stage completed. The second stage, beware of things that go bump in the night, and we're now in a cemetery, which is no place for a baby to be walking through. And the clash of the graphics is even worse here, with virtually all the background objects being white, and the baby being white as well, you can barely see it. Also, there's lots of white skeletons and things, which are also difficult to see. So the enemies get a little bit more difficult to navigate now. To get rid of. You don't navigate enemies. So there's bats flying at you, there's things bouncing around, there's cats. And also the milk kind of only appears on screen for a couple of seconds, so you've got to try and keep your eye out for where the milk appears and then shoot it. Oh, I've got to shoot that cloud there. There's another milk there and a cat. So I've just got 12 nuggets, which means I've got an extra baby. These things are particularly difficult to get, although I've got a good shot on that there. There's more milk. So the music's quite nice on it, you know, sets the scene for this particularly terrifying level. I'm doing quite well so far, just need to keep my eye on things. In this one you can shoot the tombstones to fill up the graves in some places, and in other places, oh, I missed it. Oh, I just did it in time. Oh, I thought I did it. No, baby fell in a grave. So it's because I thought you were going to have to shoot the tombstone, and on that case, it was a cloud above the hole. Unfortunately, when you lose a life, you go right back to the beginning of the level every time, which is a bit infuriating. Oh, come here, you little sod. There we go. So other than fairly woeful graphics, I actually quite like this game. It's definitely one of the better games on the device. I think the baby stops when there's a flower there, so it's probably best not to shoot the flowers. Ooh, I don't know what I shot there. Something I wasn't expecting to be able to shoot and get points for. This baby consumes a lot of milk, by the way. This is by far the most annoying enemy to get rid of, and it's got the baby because I couldn't get it, the bloody bouncing cat. Let's go one more time. Yeah, you can shoot the moon. Didn't know that. What happened? Oh, the cat got the baby, I wasn't paying attention. So that's game over basically, that's as far as I've got. But I do quite like it. It's an interesting concept. Probably worked better with the zapper than the crosshairs. But again, quite an interesting challenge and a nice idea of protecting the baby as it makes its way across the level. So that brings me to the final game of the 15 and what I think is the best game on the Rumble Station. That's Crystal Mines, which features a CM205 mining robot. And as you can see there, it's made by Colour Dreams, unsurprisingly. One or two players, obviously I'm going to be doing a single player game. So it's got lots of information on this, lots of instructions. Basically, you've got a mine with crystals in, unsurprisingly. That tells you what you use in controlling in the game. There's lots of different things, objects, dirt, crystals, boulders, mud, hard mud, lava, bombs, bags of gold, various power-ups, creature protection, explosion protection, mud lava protection, radiation protection, lots of different things there, and some creatures obviously that are going to try and stop you from mining. Soft, hard, impervious and radioactive creatures, mud creatures, lava creatures and gas creatures. And it's also got the controls for the game, so you can see you've got an energy blast, the ability to drop bombs, and also self-destruct. Why you want to do that, I'm not entirely sure. Extra points if your creature is destroyed by a falling object, extra points for bombs left, exit square may be hidden. Okay, I think we've seen enough. Lots of instructions. Let's get on with the game. So basically, I can best describe it as a cross between Repton or Boulder Dash. Oh, that wasn't a very good start, was it? I'm paying attention. I can best describe it, I'll try again, as a cross between Repton or Boulder Dash, basically a crystal collecting game, and Bomberman, because you've got the ability to drop bombs and dispose of enemies that way. It's definitely got that Bomberman style look. If you ever played the NES version of Bomberman, it does look that way, very similar to this. So you can blast through the dirt, to collect whatever you can find in the dirt. There is a time limit on each level. The aim is to collect all the diamonds and get to the exit, which is probably on the right hand side of the screen if I remember correctly. So it's effectively a Boulder Dash type clone. I think you can even shoot the rocks, you know, if I remember right. Yeah, you can. Depending probably on the strength of the rocks, that is. I've picked something up there, that's probably bombs. The rocks do fall and can be pushed around as well, as you might have already noticed. So as it mentioned, you get more points for killing enemies with a rock, so let's see if we can do that. This guy's ripe for the destroying. There we go. Got him. And maybe this one as well, actually. Oh, I missed him. So if you miss him, you can shoot him as well, which is good. They're not too difficult to get rid of at the moment. But I'm sure you can imagine it's going to get more difficult. So the graphics are pretty basic, they're kind of the style of these kind of games. They're each graphic item fits into a little square so that they can formulate the levels out of lots of little squares. Music's quite nice. Seems to be two different types of music. There's a jolly sort of tune, and then there's another one when you pick up certain power-ups, it changes to this more like sort of tense music for some reason. I don't know why. It doesn't really matter. So I'm getting quite close to the end of the level. Hopefully I won't die. I haven't planted a bomb yet, just realised. Maybe I should do that. At least to show what one looks like. There you go, there's a bomb. And just as in Bomberman, the clock ticks down. Although it doesn't tell you how much it's ticking down, and the bomb blows up. I'm just going to try and take this guy out with a bomb. I don't think I'm going to manage it again. No, he's run off again. He's an elusive character. So I'll just collect the rest of these diamonds. You can see there's a target for the number of diamonds. Oh yeah, the diamonds also kind of slide off each other, which might cause problems later on. Rocks do that in Repton as well, so maybe that's what that's based on. So that's basically the first level completed. You can see the exit's just like a kind of glowing blob. Let's go into there. You get a bonus for any remaining time and also any remaining bombs. And then on you move to the next level, which is more of the same. Now this rock takes more hits to blast through, I believe. Or maybe less, I'm not sure. But it's different. It's different to the other rock. And again, it's more of the same. Let's see if we can plant a bomb and get rid of this guy. Missed him again. Annoying. That's getting on my nerves now. Uh, I'm now on level 3 and lost a couple of lives, so I thought I'd better restart the camera in case I lose all my lives fairly quickly. It's not been going that well, really. So it's more of the same, blasting things and trying to collect the diamonds. One thing I mentioned about the monsters, if you shoot them once, they start to speed up, so you have to shoot them again before, oh god, before they get you, basically. This level's not much different to the previous one, other than the arrangement of some of the boulders is a little bit more challenging, I think. Well, it is, because that's what I've died from, is getting boulders landing on me. Of course, you can always blast the boulders. Oh, I think that was an extra life, that's useful. And like in Repton, the boulders do slide off the diamond, so it does look like it was inspired by probably a cross between Repton and Bomberman more than anything else. Quite how the American developers from Colour Dreams were inspired by Repton, I'm not sure. Maybe one of them got a BBC Micro, or maybe it's just a coincidence. So as you can tell, the music doesn't change from level to level, which means it's probably going to become a bit tiresome eventually. This is the sort of bit here that could kill you. If you go up to the top and try and collect those diamonds, then that boulder's going to fall all the way down and get you. So I won't do that. Let's just use a bomb to obliterate all this section. Save myself a bit of time. These red monsters, by the way, seem to be impervious to anything other than dropping a rock on them. As I just did. Ooh, I don't know what that is, shield. How that's different to the other thing, I'm not sure. What have we got left here? Oh, that's interesting. I'm not sure what's going on there. That looks like maybe a monster trapped beneath a rock. I don't like that. Oh, yeah, that's exactly what it was. Don't tell me I'm going to have to restart the whole level now. Oh, man, that's frustrating. Right at the end of the level. Well, certainly, it's a decent maze puzzle collect-em-up style game. Not massively challenging at the moment, although it has got more challenging obviously since the first couple of levels where I didn't lose a single life. It's just kind of working out how to navigate around the rocks really. The fact that you can shoot most of them does make life a little bit easier as well. That's quite handy. If in doubt, I think the answer is you shoot a rock and then you're taking the problem out of contention, if that's the word. Not sure how to deal with this at all. Maybe a bomb's in order there. And then perhaps when that clears that, I can push this. Yeah, here he comes. Got him. There we go, that worked. That's all the enemies eliminated on this stage. A couple of rocks, get rid of those. And the exit's over there, so that's finally got that level completed 4 lives later. So we'll have a quick look at the last level, and then I think you've probably seen enough. This is undoubtedly the best game on the console. I guess the question is whether it's worth picking one up. If you want to experience these unlicensed Colour Dreams NES games, this is pretty much the only way you can do that in the UK, I believe. So that's, and it's also a lot cheaper than doing it. Oh no, that was rubbish. I've made a right mess of that. I think that'll be game over now, yeah. It's a lot cheaper doing it this way than trying to import all the cartridges from America as well, which can be quite expensive because they're reasonably rare, because they're reasonably hard to find, because what, not that many of them were made. So in that respect, it's maybe worth a look. It's the hardware, the actual build quality of it is terrible. Pressing the buttons and having that rumble pack going all the time is really annoying. I might be tempted to open the thing up and disconnect the rumble pack so that it just works like a normal controller. Most of the games are pretty awful as well, but there are a few that make it worth picking up. Crystal Mines being one of them. The Baby Boomer one I quite like. There's quite a few platform games on there. If you like those kind of things, they might be worth persevering with, despite the somewhat terrible graphics and game design on some of them. So that's it. That's the Rumble Station. Next time I'll go back to just reviewing a normal game, because this has been quite an arduous task to cover this piece of equipment.
If you only knew the power of the dark side.
2 1 0